So the overview of this section is about the budget processes. So we are going to talk about the four stages of the budget cycle in detail, you know, in terms of the budget formulation, the enactment, the implementation, and lastly, the budget audits. So the second one, we'll be looking at what are the information that are required and the challenges, you know, for these budget cycles, you know, in order for us or the government to complete the budget, all the four stages of the budget cycle. What sort of information do they require in each and every stage, I mean, of this budget cycle? And what are the challenges that they normally come across? The third one, we'll be looking at who are the key actors in the budget cycle. So who are the people that are making the budget decisions in each and every one of these four stages? And that will actually bring us to what is called as the accountability table. The accountability table will actually give us the principles of good budgeting. So we will look and discuss more in detail in terms of the accountability table. And lastly, we will look at how the stakeholders, different stakeholders can influence the budget cycle. Particularly in this case, we are going to look at the government stakeholders in terms of the program managers, financial managers, and any other political stakeholders. So let's see how they can actually influence each and every one of these stages. So let's look at the introduction of the budget process. So though these these budgets may differ from country to country, there are like several key processes that are really similar and common in many countries, you know, and actually these are budget processes that are not really linear in their nature. These are cyclical. In other words, at any given point in time within any financial year, you're not going to get one stage of the budget process. You are going to get two, three, or more stages of the budget processes overlapping. And we are going to discuss about that, and we'll have to look at that. So that's very, very important that this is not a simple, straightforward formula. This is a complicated and cyclical formula. So the budgeting also occurs at various levels. So that means since the government has got the central level, it's got the regional level, and it's got local level. At any given time during the course of the financial year, you will see that the budgeting occurs at all these levels, which is very, very important. And that actually calls for synergy between these different levels of the government. And one of the challenges that we're going to discuss about is that you find that at different levels, the communication, the synergy is not really at a level that is required. You find that more often these government departments at different levels, they operate in silos. So lastly, the budget advocacy should be timeless. That means the timing is very, very important of when and how to intervene before the decisions are made. Because if you intervene after the decisions have been made and everything has been signed off, you will not have any influence and impact. So it's very important. So what we're going to discuss is how you can intervene and when exactly during this budget processes you can intervene. So let's look at the phases of the budget cycle. The first one is the budget formulation. So where the government needs to formulate the budgets, you know, where they actually look at the executive, where they actually have the executives that will formulate the budgets. These budgets are negotiated with the Ministry of Finance in terms of the treasuries, and they are actually aligned with the budget frameworks. These budget frameworks are actually influenced by the legislation and the policy that is within each country. So there are processes and the systems that will actually inform the executive in formulating these budgets. And these are actually mainly developed by the Ministry of Finance in conjunction with the Parliament. So once the budget has been formulated, then the Minister of Finance, through the Ministry of Finance, actually tables these budgets, the consolidated sector budgets in Parliament. And when in Parliament, the MP, that is the members of Parliament, they actually interrogate, you know, these budgets that are formulated by different ministries. And in order for them to be able to do that, they need to get these budgets well in advance. Ideally, in theory, they need to get this at least 3 weeks or a month before the minister can table that, so that they can actually get time to go through them and analyze. But under normal circumstances, you find that this is just like a formality, because you will find that the ruling party, the majority, the party that is in the majority in the parliament, will just like a rubber stamp. But ideally, this is supposed to be that. Once this has been like presented by the minister and the parliament, through the members of the parliament, accept it, then it is actually stamped and signed into law. Once it has been signed into law, it becomes binding, you know. And once it becomes binding, then the government institutions, through the cabinet, need to execute this budget in terms of budget implementation, through the structures and the systems, and they actually implement this budget through the government programs for service delivery. And once they've done that, they actually need to do an oversight every year end. And the oversight is normally done by like an oversight institution. In many countries, these oversight institutions are called the auditor generals, where they actually do the auditing, and they actually present these audit results in parliament. Sorry. And then once they've done that, they actually use, you know, the feedback that they've got from the auditing, you know, to actually formulate the budget for the next financial year. In other words, this is like a recurring cycle. And within that, you know, this budget cycle, it's a 3-year rolling budget, where you actually do the financial planning for the next financial year and the 2 outer years. So this is a medium term expenditure framework, you know. So it's called the multi-year rolling budget for 3 years. So these are basically, in a nutshell, you know, the 4 stages of the budget cycle. So let's now unpack each and every one of these cycles, you know, in detail. So the phase one, which is budget formulation. So the first thing there is the identification of needs and the policy priorities, where the ministries and the government programs, they actually look at, you know, the policy priorities in terms of the strategic objectives and the needs on the ground. And they use that information, you know, to develop their policies and also to develop their programs in terms of the business plans, in terms of the operational plans, and any other like institutional plans that they need to work on. These should be informed by these strategic and policy priorities. So once they've done that, they need to draft the budget submissions that are prepared by the spending agencies at all levels, whether at national, regional, or local levels. I mean, based on their policy priorities and situational analysis. Once these are submitted, they actually are submitted through the budget hearings that happen between the ministries and the Ministry of Finance. Once the Ministry of Finance approves those, you know, justification, then the submission becomes successful. So, like I've said, you know, I've spoken about the budget hearing. So once the budget hearings have happened and there was these negotiations between the ministries, like in terms of Ministry of Health and other ministries that are implementing these budgets, and the Minister of Finance, once there's that agreement between them, then you know the Ministry of Finance will consolidate all these sector budgets, and they actually allow you know the Minister of Finance to actually present what is called the pre-budget statement, which is that medium budget policy statement that normally happens just after mid-year, after 6 or 7 months of implementation. This is the budget, this is the pre-budget statement that actually gives, you know, the precedence to the main budget speech that normally happens towards the end of each financial year. So how do you then engage with this stage? That is the formulation stage. So if you want to have the impact and the influence as one of the government stakeholders, you know, to either increase the budgets or to advocate for adequate budgets, you have to understand the actors, the people that are making decisions. You know, in different countries and in different contexts, different organizations and actors will actually make this decision. One of these common actors will be the research offices, the treasuries, the donor agencies, the IMF, the World Banks, and so forth and so on. So once you understand these are the institutions that you need to engage and discuss, you know, these budgets with. Secondly, what you need to understand the difficulties, you know, during these stages. One of the difficulties is the lack of information, you know, that will inform the budget decision. More especially the costing data, where you find that the unit costing, you know, is really far-fetched. When you look at the market unit cost, they are most of the time very different when you compare with what the government is using. And also in terms of the spread of the diseases, in terms of the burden, in terms of the accurate population statistics, you know, more often you find that the stats that is used to develop the coverage data in terms of the target setting is not always accurate and would actually distort, you know, the budgeting and the budget estimation. Some of the information is really not accessible or it's not available. And where you find that the government institutions, you know, they don't really keep, you know, a track of important information, where data management is really, really an issue, which really compromises, you know, proper and effective planning. So those are some of the challenges that are realized within the stage. So how can different stakeholders influence this stage? The first one, as a stakeholder within the government system, you need to conduct your own relevant costing and your own needs assessment, so that when you contest any information that is available within the government, you actually benchmark it against what you know the best, what you have actually conducted yourself. So without that, it's very difficult for you to contest anything. So if the government would say, listen, based on the information that we have, this is the budget that we give in your program. And when you feel that the budget is insufficient and you don't have any information to counter that, therefore it becomes very difficult for you to advocate for more funding. So the second one is to analyze policies. You have to know the policy priorities so that you can be able to identify the gaps in terms of the unfunded mandate of the policies. Also, you need to analyze the past performances, the past performance reports. You know, and more often you find that many government officials, they don't really do this analysis. You know, even if they do, they don't really do it at that overall and really informative level. Once you have done policy analysis and you have analyzed the past performance reports and you have actually analyzed budgets and expenditures, the information that you generate from these would be so useful for you to plan ahead. And thirdly, you need to engage with the relevant budget decision makers. They say 90% of budget advocacy lies on you knowing the right people that are making the decisions. Because if you don't engage the people that make decisions, you'll probably not succeed. So you need to understand the people that are making decisions in terms of the health program, directors and the managers, also the head of the departments in terms of like permanent secretaries, and the people that are actually managing these finances, the chief financial officers and so forth and so on. These are the people that you really, really need, the people that have the power to decide how much gets allocated to any of the interventions within the government. And once you have analyzed all these policies, you have actually understood where the people are making these, then write letters that are going to be informed by this information, either to the health ministers or to the finance ministers. And these letters should actually have the messages that are actually informed by evidence, that are evidence-based, that no one can dispute. So the second phase, which is the budget enactment. So this is one of the shortest stages where the Minister of Finance tables the consolidated budget in Parliament. So if the Parliament agrees with that, they actually stamp it and it's actually passed into law. So, and once there's been passed into law, it becomes an appropriation act and it's legally binding. That's very, very important. So how do you then engage with this? So you need to understand first and foremost, like we did, the actors. So who are the actors that you need to engage with prior to the budget being enacted? So the Minister of Finance is one of the key stakeholders. And the portfolio committees within the parliament is also important. So within the health sector, we'll have to focus mainly on the health portfolio committees. So, and once you can engage with the health portfolio committee members, then you are able to influence them with the information that you've generated in your policy analysis, in your budget and expenditure analysis, in all what you have done. Then you actually stand a chance in empowering these health portfolio committee members to challenge the Minister of Finance if there's anything that is not really in line with the needs on the ground or the policy priorities. So also you need to understand who are the government spending agencies that need to defend these allocations. And if you can also empower these spending agencies, that would be great. So what is the information that is required? So these are, you need to have the budget statements, the citizens' budget. Normally you find that once the Ministry of Finance through its minister has presented presented the budget, the parliament will actually draft, what is called the citizens' budget. In a layman's language, because these budget statements can have the financial jargons that a layman's person sometimes would not really understand what they mean. So they need to summarize in the simple local language that they can actually disseminate to the local members and the communities. Once these are disseminated, you need to familiarize yourself with it, because sometimes these citizen budgets might not really contain full information. So if you can really influence those and the appropriation law, then that information will assist you. So what are the difficulties? So one of the difficulties is the lack of costing information. When these budgets are allocated, they are normally not allocated based on proper and accurate unit costing. They are developed based on political agendas most of the times, and they are sometimes developed based on inadequate and incomplete data. So those are some of the challenges. The second one, the portfolio committee members, most of the times you find that these are just ordinary politicians that do not really have the skills and the information to analyze these budgets. And sometimes they're not really interested in the critical health issues. So if you can really, really advocate, you know, for these committee members to have the right information, and sometimes to actually train them so that they can have the skills and the interest, you know, to critically analyze this health budget, then you will be a step ahead. So also the civil society organizations comments, some they actually come very late when the decisions are made, you know. And sometimes if you partner with these CSOs that actually have like a financial muscle, and sometimes they have like you know, the freedom to say these things in the public, sometimes if you empower them, then you'll actually achieve something. The lack of access to information law is in some countries is very, very critical. You know, sometimes you find that you've got, you know, the barriers to these to access some of the information, and there are no legislative frameworks that are in place to actually allow, you know, some of the stakeholders to have information. I mean, the access to some of the information. So these are some of the barriers. And sometimes you find that even if there are those laws, you know, the information is not really publicly available, and you don't really know where to find this information. So the research and the know-how and creating, you know, those partnerships with the decision makers would really, really solve a lot of these challenges. Because even if the information is not publicly available, if you have that relationship with the decision makers, they can actually give you access to that information. How can stakeholders influence this? So most of this is really similar to the first phase. You know, you need to analyze policy and budget statements, make submissions in terms of like letters that are evidence-based, analyze and release budget briefs, like we have said. So phase three, where you actually execute and expenditure and manage expenditures. So this is through like government structures, you know, where money is transferred to spending agencies, like that is your ministries, departments, or government agencies. Secondly, agencies, they initiate spending through payrolls and procurement of goods and services, purchase capital assets and infrastructure. So now what is important in this stage is that you need to understand the critical ministry structures of the ministries and the systems, you know, within these ministries that will actually allow for these financial flows towards service delivery. So once you have understood that, you know, you would then be in a better position to advocate, you know, for adequate funding. Then the payments are made. So financial information is continually produced and recorded by financial systems. These financial systems, the reason why I put a question mark here, are very, very critical. But more often you find that these systems are weak and they have a lot of loopholes, you know, where you find that certain stakeholders within the government sector actually manipulate their systems. And you have to understand this system in order for you to understand these loopholes, so that when you advocate for more resources and adequate resources, you can actually capitalize and address these gaps that are within these financial systems. So you have to actually understand the supplementary budgets and adjustment to the budgets. These adjustments, they happen every 6 months where the government actually allow by law that the departments can really reprioritize. They say, okay, you have actually spent some money over the 6 months period. Let's reprioritize based on certain developments that have actually taken place during the 6 months. Let's shift monies where you are underspending to where you are overspending, or vice versa. So engaging with this execution phase. Firstly, like in any other phase, you need to understand the decision makers. So in this case, the treasuries, the spending agencies, the Supreme Audit Institution in terms of your internal audit officers, your portfolio committees within parliament, research institutions. So these research institutions and academics are very critical because they've got the ability to generate, you know, the information that normally, you know, we wouldn't be able to do within government sector. Civil society monitoring groups, you know, which are very, very good in budget advocacy. And the information that is required, these are the budget statements. We have to get access to that. And these budget statements, they also need, more often you find that within these budget statements, you only have the budget allocations, but you don't have the expenditure records. And it's not always the case that any budget that is allocated is automatically spent. Sometimes the budgets that are allocated are not spent in the right intervention that they were meant for. So when you do proper expenditure analysis, therefore you can determine whether these allocations have been utilized in the right goods and services. So the strategic and operational plans are very important because these actually will tell you about the budget plans that the government has. So the in-year accounting, that is your in-year monitoring, either monthly, quarterly, semi-annually, and annually. So you look at the performance reports where you actually marry the financial indicators in terms of financial performance and the non-financial indicators in terms of the programmatic performance. So when you marry those, then you can really identify the gaps or the discrepancies that therefore appear. So the year-end accounting, which is your annual performance reports through the auditor financial statements, you know, and this actually goes hand in hand with annual evaluation. So how can stakeholders influence this stage? Ongoing monitoring of implementation. This is a must. So you don't wait until it's end of the year or it's the end of the quarter where you actually realize that, wow, there was a mistake that was made during the first month of the year. And you only realize towards the 6 months of the year. So you need to constantly monitor, you know, the implementation of the budget. If you don't do that, you're most likely to be lost within the system. So have a bird's eye view of all concurrent budget processes. So you must have that oversight ability where you actually have that ability to look, you know, far ahead, you know, in terms of the ultimate aim, because more often you find that the managers, they just focus on what they do and they don't have that bigger picture of how they are contributing into that bigger policy priority. So once we have that ability to have the policy priority and unpack it and understand every contribution that you have in your program, how it actually contributes toward that bigger picture, then it will actually assist you to have that better analytical ability. Phase four, which is the oversight and the assessment. So where the Auditor General or the Parliament through the Auditor General audit, you know, the performance of all the ministries, you know, after a year. So the oversight is the act of limiting the discretion of the executive arm of the government by monitoring its decision. So in other words, in this stage, the government is saying, you know what, the executive is given all the resources, but we should limit the powers that they have, where we have an external organization that has like some powers in terms of like monitoring what they do. So which is normally that Auditor General institution. A number of bodies are responsible for oversight in a constitutional democracy, including Parliament, Portfolio Committee, and the Auditor General, which is the Supreme Audit Institution. So the Auditor General is actually an institution that is appointed by the Parliament through the Portfolio Committee. So that's why they actually have that oversight and the monitoring role of the executive, so that the executive can be accountable to the Parliament, which is the people of the land. So the powers and the capabilities of oversight bodies need to be to hold the executive into account. That's very, very, very critical. So if the executive is not held into account, therefore, there is a likelihood that the resources will be misused, they will be misappropriated, and all sorts of things. And now it's very, very important that you really understand, you know, the mechanisms within this phase, so that when you try and influence and advocate for a change, you would know how to use the stage appropriately and effectively. So let's look at the types of audits. You know, there are three major types of audits. The first one is financial audit, where the Auditor General look at the accuracy, you know, of your spending. And if your spending is not accurate according to what has been approved, so your spending is beyond what has been approved, then there's a disclaimer that is given, which is actually called the unauthorized expenditure. So the second one is where the Auditor General looks at the compliance processes, you know, in terms of spending the government resources. You need to follow the system and the account, I mean the compliance procedures. If for some reason, you know, those procedures are not followed and the monies are spent without following those procedures, then the Auditor General will actually find you to have contravened, you know, the processes. And that is called the unauthorized and it's called the irregular expenditure. So if you flout or you don't follow any processes, you just spend the money, that is called irregular expenditure. The third one is the performance audit, where the government really wants to see the value for the money that they invest. If at any stage you find that the government spends the money, but there's no proper benefits that you can see from that spending that money, then Auditor General will declare that expenditure as fruitless, it's fruitless and wasteful expenditure. Yeah. So those are the three categories of audits. You can either fall in one of these, or you've got clean audit that does not have any audit query. So how can stakeholders influence the budget oversight and assessment by auditors? So you need to really, really formulate that friendship. You know, you need to have that a healthy relationship with the Auditor General. And when you have that relationship with the Auditor General, the benefit is that if there's any chance that you actually not spending the government resources appropriately, they will actually guide you. That's number one. Secondly, if there are any findings that they find, they can easily share that information with you, and then you can use that information for corrective measures, you know, moving forward for your future planning. And also, if you want to change anything, you can really discuss that with them, and then you can actually include them, in their report. So analyze performance reports, budgets versus expenditures, like in other stages, and also engage with the relevant budget decision makers. So this is very, very critical. You need to know who are the people who are making these decisions.